BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and I'm welcoming you to this wonderful evening of entertainment information here. I'm just so pleased that I'll be talking about two different theater troupes, and both mean a lot to me as I've worked with one on the boards and behind the scenes, and the other one I've been very fortunate to be able to help promote their works up in the Lehigh Valley. They've been very marvelous to me. That's the Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival, and I have to say that talking to these people and talking for these people, it's part of them and part of me, what we did for love. And we'll do that, we'll find out a little bit more of that from that line a little bit later when we talk about the Shakespeare Festival, because they will be doing a chorus line and we'll be finding out a little bit more about what, where and when that's going to happen. But first of all, I'd like to welcome my guests from the Reading Civic Theater. And I've had some of them on the program before, and a few are new to the program, so let's welcome them all and find out what they're doing and who they are. Okay, with me tonight, to my left, is Jeannette DeAngelo. Welcome back.
Thanks for having us, Dave.
You're
welcome.
It's
good to be here.
Seated next to Jeannette is Dave Jones. Welcome to Backstage.
Thank you very much.
And seated next to Dave is Hannah Reininger.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yes.
Hey, score one for the guy.
Yes.
And last but certainly not least, Paige Anderson. Welcome to Backstage.
Thank you, thank you.
You're welcome. Now, these are some of the folks that are involved in the production of Disney's Descendants, and that's going to be opening in a little bit, and we'll find out, first of all, where and when the production is going to open. Jeannette, if you would be kind enough to tell us where and when Disney's Descendants is going to be held.
Okay, I would be delighted, especially because Reading Civic Theater has found a new home.
Oh, good.
We are going to be opening up our new venue, mm-hmm, with the Berks County premiere of Disney's The Descendants. And we are beyond excited. Little tired, but beyond excited. And we will be doing the show June 10th, 11th, mm-hmm, and 12th. And then the following weekend, which is a first for us, we've not ever done any shows two weekends in a row.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So again, June 16th, 17th, 18th, and 19th. And so we have lots of reasons to be smiling, to be happy, and to, mm-hmm, be energetic. So, yes. Mm-hmm. It's the old Fox Theater building.
Okay.
I don't know if I said that, because in my excitement.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
I was going to say we can find out a little bit more,
yeah,
about that.
Absolutely.
And a little bit. First of all, I'd like to get an idea what Disney's Descendants is all about.
I can give you a pretty quick synopsis.
Okay.
So pretty much the synopsis of Descendants is that imprisoned on the Isle of the Lost, this is pretty much where all the villainous heroes and such of the Disney franchise, all the villains are pretty much there living at the Isle of the Lost. It focuses around the four, teenagers of the most famous Disney villains, which are Maleficent, Jafar, Cruella de Vil, and then of course we have the evil queen, Queen Brunhilde. Once we get to that, they are sent to Auradon Prep to actually go to school with most of the children from the Disney heroes. So they come to the school and they actually meet a lot of the people, and they actually face the question of whether they want to learn to be good at Auradon Prep or actually follow within their parents' footsteps of being wicked and being evil.
Okay. That sounds like quite an interesting premise there.
Yes.
Jeannette, you're working on the show in what capacity?
I'm the producer.
Okay.
Yep. And it's been interesting because it's probably the first time I've stepped back and am not directing in I don't even want to tell you how many years. So I'm listening and I'm kind of watching from afar. So last night I got to see a little bit of the show. I don't know if I would say it was most of the show. I feel like it was kind of a run through and it is awesome. They do a fabulous job and I kind of really like the premise. You know, it's a really good, has a really good message to it.
Yeah.
And I like messages.
And Dave, what is your capacity with
the right show? Well, right now I'm basically working between two buildings.
Okay.
We are trying to transition the Fox Theater into a live theater. And believe it or not, going from a movie theater to a live theater is quite a change.
I can imagine.
There were seats to remove, a stage to build. We're installing lights, just a myriad of things. And while that's happening, we're trying to get out of our old building on 10th Street. So there's props, there's set pieces, there's everything imaginable transferred from the city out to Exeter and vice versa. And in the meantime, the paint's flying and the the wood shavings are everywhere. But it's quite an undertaking, something that, and we have a deadline.
Yes.
We have to be finished in 2 weeks. And we're close. We're close.
I remember that type of work back in my undergraduate school. I ended up taking the theater department from tin can chairs and tin can lights and folding chairs. Folding lights.
That's okay.
Anyway.
Anyway.
It had been an old paint shop, an old coffee shop. It could have tasted like paint, who knows. Anyway, we went from that to ended up having fixed seating in there in a three-quarter round. We could have actually made it into a full round, but that, and then we did shows in there, very tiny, and all made for intimate experiences for the audience, but and then downstairs was where we did everything, paint, change clothes, everything. So going from there to a beautiful new building was quite an adventure, and I commend you folks for going on that venture. It's amazing.
And it's
a lot
journey.
Of work.
It's a journey for sure.
It's a journey.
How have you liked the transition so far? Has it gone reasonably smoothly, or is it one of those?
Yes and no.
Okay. Murphy hit, eh?
You have those days where you're never quite sure what's going to happen. We've been very, very fortunate. to work through a lot of these problems. Mm-hmm. We certainly could use some more help. Mm-hmm. But it's mind-boggling, not only the physical activity, but just mm-hmm. the planning mm-hmm. and just thinking through right. issues is very, very difficult. Very difficult.
Lots of phone calls.
Lots of phone calls.
to make it all work. Mm-hmm. And you've been in Civic's building, mm-hmm. the old building. Mm-hmm. It's four floors mm-hmm. of stuff.
Oh yes.
For mm-hmm. 50 plus years. Mm-hmm. And trying to say, okay, what do we keep mm-hmm. that we will be using in the future? Mm-hmm. What do we get rid of mm-hmm. that's just not worth saving? And you know, then there's the maybe pile. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the maybe pile's just getting really too big. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's just been a mm-hmm. journey that mm-hmm. started 3 years ago, and mm-hmm. we're lucky.
Well, I'm happy for you and all. And you do get a little bit of the benefit there as far as having adequate parking.
Oh,
yes.
Yes. Oh,
yes.
That is a definite
absolutely.
Plus.
Yeah, and the thought of bringing new life into an old building mm-hmm. like that is mm-hmm. is really, really
right.
cool
right.
that we're able to do that, and especially be the first show mm-hmm. in this new space. It's really, mm-hmm. really exciting.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's just, you know, such a cool experience to have, you know, being able to go into a theater like that and watch shows like that, because mm-hmm. there's not a lot of places that do that around here anymore mm-hmm. that is just so immersive like that. Right. So I think us being able to premiere the Berks County premiere in that building in mm-hmm. that fashion is definitely a really cool experience, right. seriously.
Yes, it does. Now, have you two been helping with some of the backstage elements with this and the move and all, or have you just been basically concentrating on the show and your characters?
I think we've both tried our very best to help in both aspects
good.
As much
yeah.
as possible, of course.
Yeah, definitely. It takes a village, and also,
oh, mm-hmm.
and we've gotten to witness it firsthand, like
yes.
throughout our rehearsals.
Yes.
Everyone's there mm-hmm. every night doing everything, painting the lobby. We're out in the lobby while the stage is still under construction, so we get to see all of
right.
the hardworking people volunteering mm-hmm. their time to do this.
And just the magic from the beginning of it all to now is just so tremendous and amazing. Like, we've
yeah.
just made so much improvement and progress that it's going to be so great in the end.
It's and it's
so cool.
really inspiring to see how many people that want to come together and
mm-hmm. right.
do this
yeah.
for Running mm-hmm. Civic.
Absolutely.
It's really
yeah.
great.
Definitely.
Yeah, this is something that you can really treasure as you go on, saying
mm-hmm.
that you were part of a new theater
yeah.
and helping to put it together and do the first show. You're actually living up to some of the better tenets of theater and acting. Stanislavski was always saying that you should at least know everything that's going on into a production.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You don't have to be proficient in it, but if you know it and understand it, you appreciate everything that everyone
totally.
Else is doing
absolutely.
For you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
and some of the things I kind of hope that some of our viewers out there will get a chance to experience to understand all the work and the timing and everything
mm-hmm. yeah.
else that has to occur to make it, the magic happen.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Hannah,
sure.
tell us a little bit about you and your theater credits and your character in the show.
Sure, yes. Well, I am a current music theater student at Temple University, mm. so I've been doing this for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So this summer I was really, really excited to be able to come together and work with Reading Civic on Descendants. I play Evie, which is the evil queen, Grimhilda's daughter from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Earlier on in the show, her mom has very, very much emphasized to her very superficial things. A lot of exterior, how she looks on the outside, that she looks pretty,
mm-hmm.
to focus on boys, you know.
Mm-hmm.
She says it's what's on the outside that counts. And
yes.
so quickly after traveling to Ordon, she actually quickly realizes that she's actually really, really smart, and she enjoys learning and being in school, and she really thrives being in that kind of environment. So it's really cool to see her character arc throughout the show. I don't want to give away too much,
mm-hmm.
but it's very, very cool to see mm-hmm. her character arc throughout the show mm-hmm. and the, yeah. the transition that she goes through. Yeah. Definitely.
What's it been like for you to go to this type of a character? Have you played generally nice people? Average people?
Yes. I have. It's definitely been interesting. I mean, Descendants is a very different show than your mm-hmm. normal musical theater type mm-hmm. pieces. It's a hip hop show. We do a lot of hip hop choreography. Oh, there's a mm-hmm. lot of really cool like techno urban music. So it's been a very, very different kind of piece that I've worked on before. Mm-hmm. It's based off of the Disney Channel movies Descendants that was directed and produced by Kenny Ortega, who was famous for the High School Musical movies. So it has mm-hmm. those kind of mm-hmm. vibes, the Disney Channel teen vibes mm-hmm. Of that, but it's a brand new concept that I think is really, really cool and definitely not anything that Berks County has seen before. So it's really, really exciting that we're gonna mm-hmm. be able to bring something new to the table here in our brand new theater.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In preparing for this character, what have you done to understand and get into that kind of character? Because a lot of times you know, your hero and all that,
yeah.
you know, it's pretty much facade in mm-hmm. a sense. But to get involved in the mind of an evil person or whatever, yeah. that takes a lot of different things. What has it been like for you to work on your role?
Definitely. I think, especially with Evie, even though she is kind of called a villain kid, I mm-hmm. think she's a character that a lot of girls, and especially this generation, can kind of relate to. Mm-hmm. Not saying that like a mother figure has told them about these superficial things, but mm-hmm. it's easy to kind of think that way, to kind of feel like mm-hmm. that you're focusing on your looks or mm-hmm. feeling like you have to act dumb to mm-hmm. to get a boyfriend. And so I feel like I was able to relate to her in the kind of way, in certain ways like that. So it's been really cool to kind of dive deeper into her character more and kind of quickly realize by the end of the show that, you know, they really aren't evil people, even though they were labeled to be because mm-hmm. of their parents, mm-hmm. That they were from this area, that they were kind of stereotypically mm-hmm. had mm-hmm. to be evil. And they mm-hmm. kind of, I guess you could see, end up defying that, hopefully, or maybe not, by the end of the show.
Well, they make their own way.
Yes.
And they make their own life.
Exactly.
Right? Mm-hmm. And that doesn't give anything away. It's
yeah.
just what today is about.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You know, all of our youth have to
yeah.
make their own way
mm-hmm.
and find their own path.
Exactly.
You know, and it's not easy in the world we live in today.
No.
So what you've identified and what you've brought out is truly talked about. Well, it's what the show mm-hmm. is about.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You're not always who you're come from. Where you come from, you know. Mm-hmm. At its core, Descendants is a show about empathy and tolerance and acceptance, and mm-hmm. hopefully by the end of the show we can really drive the message to the audience that no matter where we come from, no matter who we are, we're all better and stronger mm-hmm. together.
Yeah. You find out that there's not, no one is really all evil and no
yeah.
one is really all good.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
We've always had that.
Yeah, you can be good, and it's like lines that we have in the show. You mm-hmm. there can be good or bad no matter where you come mm-hmm. from.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Kind of a so. Tug of war.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely. Yeah, especially because one of the biggest villains of the show is on the good side of mm-hmm. the people. So it's definitely interesting yeah. to kind of see that transpire. Yeah.
How about you, Paige? Tell us about your character and some of your theater background. And
yes.
And we'll get into
so I graduated from Hamburg in 2017, mm-hmm. And I actually found Reading Civic Theater through Facebook, through mm-hmm. a random friend one day, and I auditioned for Footloose, thinking, oh, you know, this is just gonna be a show. Like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. And, mm-hmm. you know, I ended up getting Ariel and Footloose, and, like, since then I just became so obsessed with Reading Civic Theater, and I pretty much am, you know, stage rat at this point. Mm-hmm. but to go into character, Mal, she's the daughter of Maleficent, and Mal is just this very free-going, sarcastic, just fun-loving person who's very loyal to herself and loyal to her morals, and especially when it comes to her mom. I really noticed that Mal's relationship with her mom, Maleficent, is something that's very dynamic and very different from any experience I've had with any sort of mother-daughter relationship in shows. You see a lot of the tension that, you know, Maleficent and Mal have when it comes to wanting to prove to each other that they love each other, even though they want to hold this persona that they're so bad and they're so evil, mm-hmm. along with the fact that Mal takes so much of her time to impress Maleficent and want to show her, you know, that she can be just as evil. Mal also just likes to get to a lot of trouble and a lot of fun antics and stuff, and you know, she's best friends with Carlos and Jay and Evie, so you know, she pretty much is the leader out of the, you know, group, and really just takes on the job of making sure everyone's just on, you know, cue, on their P's and Q's, making sure, you know, the plan is going as well. But Mal, to me, is a really, really astonishing role, and it's been a dream role of mine for a while. And I'm really excited that, you know, not only is this the Berks County premiere, but I get to do it, and I'm really grateful for that opportunity. But yeah, it's definitely a different role to play than most things I've played at RCT, you know, compared to a nun.
Talk about a 180, and Sandy.
Yes. So going from, you know, Sandy and Grease being so, you know, proper and petite and nice, to being someone so sarcastically, you know, fun and evil, and just gets so much pleasure out of making fun of people and causing chaos. It's definitely a cool experience, definitely.
Do you think Mal really wants to please her mother, and she does the evil things to get her mother's attention and love?
I have a very good feeling that Mal has that intention of doing that.
Yeah.
She's very loyal to her feelings and her morals, so I feel that, you know, Mal being so close to her mom, she just wants to prove to her so bad that she can be just as evil. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, Maleficent also leads, you know, Jafar and Cruella de Vil and Queen Grimhilda, so they're kind of just trying to compare each other more so in how so they're being evil. And I think Mal really wants to impress Maleficent in that way. Mm-hmm. And I really see that within her character.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Where have you had to go to start going to the other side, so to speak, the dark side, however you want to phrase
it? Oh, gosh.
Because, you know, it isn't something that one normally goes to unless one has those tendencies and that personality. And you two certainly don't strike me as that.
No.
But everybody has that little, at least a little bit of mischievousness and all that. What have you done to get to that point and accept it that, you know, the whole of the human experience?
So I think just because of, you know, Descendants being so iconic and being so popular, Mal and Evie and the Evils, you know, they have to be so spot on and so correct that I've really taken my time to watch the movie, really take some time to do some character work, really just diving into my character. Especially, like I said, because it's just so iconic that people really just want to see how everything unfolds and everything like that. So I really try my best to dive in to how she really takes the fun out of making things chaotic and coming up to people and being blunt and being just in your face and just fun and everything like that. Just really like taking in that, you know, energy and manifesting it is just something that, you know, just takes some work. But I think the rehearsals, and I think Hannah can definitely attest to that, they make it so fun that it's almost, you know, not difficult for me to be that way. It's just so fun, and the experience and the atmosphere just make it so great like that.
And to kind of go off of that, they're not really your stereotypical villain characters.
Oh,
they're
yes.
very, very likable, and it's very easy to find the love in the characters because I think each of the characters is so desperately trying to find the love from their parents, too, that you can really feel that in their characters. So I think it's been really easy to kind of find likable things in each of these characters because they're really not evil.
Yes.
They kind of want to be accepted for being
exactly.
maybe evil or cunning and that sort of
thing.
I think they're just kids.
Yeah.
You know, reaching out to get their parents' attention.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And yeah. so, mm-hmm. you know, the perception is, oh, well, their parents are evil, mm-hmm. so they're evil, mm-hmm. when in fact they are, you use the right word, they're more mischievous mm-hmm. and yes. curious because of their age.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, and what's this good island all about? Yeah. And who's on the good island?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So that's my perception of watching it and hearing it.
Yeah.
You know?
And how those on the good island may not be quite that pristine, perfect.
No, exactly.
Now that they, people might want to expect of them.
Yeah.
You know? So now you've been rehearsing over there. Where have you been rehearsing in the building itself?
So we've been rehearsing in our lobby area because okay. we've been taking just our, you know, time and days and months and all of our energy just to build the stage within mm-hmm. the theater. Mm-hmm. It's definitely a lot of work. You mm-hmm. know, you're taking a movie theater that is only supposed to really be for, of course, watching movies mm-hmm. and really changing it into a ultrasounded theater that mm-hmm. is immersive for all audiences. Mm-hmm. And once everyone sees this product, I'm telling you, it's gonna be amazing. Mm-hmm. The amount of progress we made to the stage right now and from what we've seen, it's mm-hmm. so good. It really, really is. And mm-hmm. I think it's gonna shock people. I think it really will.
Mm-hmm. You know, and it is a work in progress.
Right.
We are,
mm-hmm.
we're going to have it to a point where it's acceptable,
mm-hmm.
but it's not going to be finished.
No.
Right, right. No, it's a very long, ongoing mm-hmm. process to fine-tune it, because on the way you'll find out, oh, this really isn't working as well as we thought it might
mm-hmm.
work, or that. I mean, again, with the new fine arts building that I went to, we had to learn to hold our hands in front of our head, because if we got too close, the cement beams mm-hmm. coming down that held the audience section and that, you could hit yourself in the head.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah.
It's just amazing to me. Mm-hmm. You would think that a theater is a theater is a theater.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And it really isn't.
Yeah.
It really isn't. We've taken a space in the front of that theater mm-hmm. that may have been 8 to 10 feet wide.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's, what, 30, 35 feet mm-hmm. wide? Mm-hmm. I mean, our stage is going to be comparable to the Rack stage.
Okay.
To the Miller.
Mm-hmm.
Without some of the wing space.
Yeah.
I was going to ask.
But the performance area is about the same size.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, because that, you, as you said, you don't have that much depth to the stage, and usually, in general, there are 40 feet wide by about 20, at least 20 feet deep, and that doesn't count if you have wing space behind mm-hmm. backstage space
right.
mm-hmm. or fly space.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And all.
Yeah, we have, it's well thought out, mm-hmm. well planned, well designed.
Right, good. Definitely.
Of course, we had to be ADA compliant.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We met all the codes and all the restrictions mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. all the hassles from. Mm-hmm. From trying to build a stage. Mm-hmm. It was very complicated.
Right.
Very, very, very complicated. Mm-hmm. Now we also have the next door stage. Mm-hmm. This is our main performance stage and another area,
mm.
which we are gonna make into our shop, our props,
okay,
costumes,
mm-hmm.
and that's another ongoing project.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And there will be a large garage door, literally,
mm.
where we can roll our props and scenery right in and right out. So
great.
It's going to be quite an interesting place.
I can't mm-hmm. wait to see it.
You're quite
yeah.
the experience.
You know what I mean? It's like, okay.
I can't wait to have a tour of that to see what's going on. And I hope you folks are taking pictures
oh,
of
absolutely.
This. And then perhaps we can do a program later on where we show your new digs there.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
The progress yeah. that was made, as mm-hmm. I think Paige alluded to, and I think she even said, their very first rehearsal mm-hmm. was in the movie theater mm-hmm. without having anything done to it.
Oh yes, with the neon yellow and neon green walls.
Yeah, I mean, we all just sat in, you know, movie theater chairs, and you know, there was just the big table of directors sitting there, and like there's, you know, curtains all over the place, yeah. And mm-hmm. clothes all over the place. We're like, okay, we know we're here, and we're gonna
and the screen.
Oh, and the big screen. Yes, of course, you can't forget that.
You know, so they've seen it from the very, very beginning. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, we've taken pictures along the way. Mm-hmm. And eventually, I will definitely be putting those pictures out there. But for right mm-hmm. now, you know, I prefer not to.
Oh, no, no.
You know,
no,
the
no.
element of surprise.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sure, sure. You need to have that moment, that celebratory moment where, hey, here we are. This is what we have.
Absolutely.
And mm-hmm. we are now finished to the point that we're finished. We may add some things later on.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I've seen a lot of that happen to other theaters mm-hmm. along the way and all. Yeah, it all depends on money, time, help, and all
right.
that other.
Right.
Stuff.
Correct.
And all.
Correct.
And all. So, what have rehearsals been like for you? You start out right in the front with maybe a lot of squish space to not work in,
yeah.
and then to at least going to the little bigger area, the lobby,
yeah.
and all, and then, so how's that been with you,
yeah.
and your work, the relationship of other actors?
Definitely, definitely. I mean, especially, we have a fairly large cast for this show.
Yes, we do.
That ranges a lot of ages, which is really, really exciting.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had to learn to be very adaptable to the rehearsal space that we're mm-hmm. going to be in, especially in the lobby. We've had to like switch sides
right.
if they're painting or doing something along those lines, being able to adapt to kind of moving around
yeah.
and being lenient around the workers that are volunteering their time to work on it. So, yeah, it's definitely been interesting
yes.
and not really experienced anything like that before, mm-hmm. but it's been really cool mm-hmm. to kind of see it all unfold while mm-hmm. we're rehearsing.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's been cool.
And how about the individual or the dynamics between actors going in this space and doing that? Has it made it crazier, better, challenging,
I would honestly say to
interact that way.
Yeah, I would say honestly the excitement of the new building honestly mm-hmm. gets people, you know, their adrenaline up a little bit. I say for me at least, because I like being able to come into the new theater and like, you know, seeing like all the different things that are being added and, you know, improved and mm-hmm. everything else. And like, it just gives me a jump and like a breath of fresh air to be like, okay, you know, we're here to rehearse.
Mm-hmm.
Brand new show, brand new building, and it just gives me just a really cool just kind of feeling.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What kind of a set are you having planning for this as far as the scene itself? Is it set pieces moving mm-hmm. all over the
Absolutely.
Place? Is it a, you know, more stable?
I think there's some of each.
Okay.
We're
yeah.
in the process. What's interesting is we built. I didn't build.
Well,
our builder
yeah.
built everything on 10th Street.
Okay.
And everything is built in pieces,
mm-hmm.
so that when we get and everything mm-hmm. is down at the new venue.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have to put it together as we go.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some large pieces
and mm-hmm. some very. Unique,
very unique,
and
pieces.
Creative pieces.
Mm-hmm. Good, very
yes.
much so.
Very cool.
So
yeah.
we're not going to say anything about
yeah.
the set again because
mm-hmm.
it is very unique
mm-hmm.
and it's very creative and it's
mm-hmm.
so cool to be the first in this area to do it
mm-hmm.
because we can be so creative.
Mm-hmm.
We're the first, and it's
mm-hmm.
like, oh, you know, maybe people will come and they'll say, hey, that's pretty cool. When we do Descendants, maybe we can utilize that idea.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
yeah, but.
Yeah,
you gotta come see it.
Oh, yeah. Same thing with costumes.
With costumes is, yeah, that's
they
right.
They don't exist,
well.
So
mm-hmm.
we have to literally make them.
Mm-hmm.
Or find them.
Or find them,
yeah.
Yeah, because
I
these two young girls have been on Amazon and whatever other social things are out there.
Lots of shopping, hunting for
What they would like to wear that emulates their characters.
Yes.
Because as they said, these are very well-known characters. So they want to very much look the part. And they will.
We will.
A little different than we do right now. That's all you have to say.
Yeah,
look a little different.
Yeah, definitely something more unique and different than what RCT usually does. Yeah. I think it really is going to, you know, push the envelope.
Yeah, you can't necessarily go out and rent the costumes or set pieces or whatever that I know has been done in the past, not only with RCT, but a number of other theaters. You know, sometimes you just don't have the ability, the talent, or whatever, to do that. When I had a program on scenic design and all, you have drops falling coming in and all, and you have to have that painted just so it looks like this. Mm-hmm. And how do you take it from a page this size to a 20 by 40 piece.
And
It looks a little different.
Yeah.
It's bigger. Yeah.
And then you grid it so that you can get that, and also then hang it so that it stays there.
Yeah.
Because again, it's live theater, and I know one of the shows I did, we had an interesting experience where one of the ropes came off of one of the flying pieces.
And, the and beauty of live theater.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And that happened about, 35, 40 minutes before the performance opened.
Oh my gosh. It was good that it wasn't during, though.
Oh, yes. Right.
There have been shows where we're working on the set, you know, in between, on the, in the blackout, we're screwing the door back on. I do a lot of stage crew.
Yeah.
And we're always back there running around trying to, how are we going to fix that?
An issue. Yeah, I was asked by the, in that particular situation that I described, you know, how are we going to do this? And I said, get me a ladder, I'll go up there. Because I had just come off of not too long before that of working with a good fly system in a summer stock theater. And I had a lot of experience, plus some of the things I learned in college and elsewhere. Mm-hmm. You know, I was happy that I could do that and all that.
There's just something really exciting about being able to say we've done it first.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm talking about in Berks County.
Right.
You know? There's just that excitement. I love being able to do a show that nobody else has done.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because it gives you that the creative outlet that many of us are looking for, both in portraying the characters. Mm-hmm. You're the first to bring Mal and Evie alive in Berks County. Mm-hmm. Our set will be unique and you know, and from all of the directorial staff, you know, their artistic vision will come to life and it'll be their vision.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody says that their vision is the only vision or the right or wrong vision. And especially when you're first, you can't be wrong.
Yeah.
Isn't that
great? That's right.
You know, it's your vision, it's your concept.
Yeah.
So I love the fact that this is the first time being done in this area.
Yeah.
And I say it that way because Dutch Apple did do it. I think that they did a workshop / performance because we saw it and was very, very good, very well done. But, you know, in Berks County, We're the first, and that's awesome. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, and who knows what you do there? Maybe the ideas may be borrowed by other theater companies. You know, professionally or amateur theater companies. And that's a way to solve a problem. And it'll you'll have that sense of pride as well as an accomplishment, as well as being a leader in things that others will follow.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So What would you say has been the most enjoyable aspect of putting this show on at this point? What's been a funny moment or whatever kind of thing, or a learning experience or something like that? What do you have to?
I think it's just really cool that, you know, with this particular show, we get to work with so many different ages. Mm-hmm. And there's not really too many shows that are out there where you can work with ages, you know, 11 to, you know, whatever mm-hmm. amount you would like to think. But I think it's just really cool that you get to experience, you know, so many different lives, mm-hmm. you know, at so many different mm-hmm. ages. And I think that was a really cool part of it, for me at least, getting to know everybody, you know, on that end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I think for me, it has been, because our characters have already been written in as such close friends, mm-hmm. I think especially the four of us who play the evil have been able to bond so closely throughout our experience through the show, mm-hmm. and as a cast more progressively over time. So it's been mm-hmm. a really, really cool experience to be able to go through this all together, and mm-hmm. especially because I didn't know anyone mm-hmm. before I started the show, and now I can call some of these people.
Yeah, I was
some
literally the welcoming
friends.
Committee, like walking in, you know. So
I'm taking these people some of my best friends now. So it's really, really cool to have that mm-hmm. as an experience.
Yes, and this cast I feel definitely feels bonded, and they all have fun with each other all the time. They're always asking how they are, and I really mm-hmm. feel that every time RCT has a show, everyone's a family. Mm-hmm. Small or large or medium, whatever size, mm-hmm. dysfunctional family. And I think it's just why I come back every single year, because RCT is just seriously my home. And
always.
Yeah. Always.
Always your home.
Always. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, not to step in on, but they're talking, she mentioned about the four evils, and it might be nice because we, you know, we couldn't have everybody here, but it might be nice for them to talk a little bit about the other two people that are part of their team.
Sure.
You know, if you wouldn't mind.
No, sure. Well, please. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you want to? We can talk about one each.
Yeah, okay. Sure.
So I can talk about Carlos. Carlos is played by our lovely and talented friend Josh Winfield, who actually commutes from Philadelphia every rehearsal.
Makes
to
a very
come.
Huge commitment for
and
this.
Yes,
so,
it is. Mm-hmm.
And so Carlos is the son of Cruella de Vil from 101 Dalmatians, mm-hmm. the iconic character. And Carlos is very skittish, very much, if any character is afraid of their parental figure, it is definitely Carlos. He's petrified of his mom and has this fear of dogs, especially throughout the show, that he quickly gets over when he travels to Auradon. And his character arc is really, really cool throughout the show, too. And yeah, we could talk about Jay.
Yes.
You want to talk about
yes,
Jay.
Absolutely. Yeah. So Jay is the son of Jafar, and he's played by Justin Snyder. Mm-hmm. Jay is the very, very just like laid back kind of guy, always thinks he's too cool for school, thinks he's cooler than everybody, and like mm-hmm. tries to have this suave that like he's mm-hmm. just so smooth. And mm-hmm. you know, you just end up seeing that he just runs into his little things here and there, and mm-hmm. you know, him and Carlos have a very, very special relationship in the show. They share a very special brother bond that not a lot of, you know, people would say mm-hmm. is just around anymore. But their bond is really strong and playful. And I would say the same thing for Mal and Evie. And a lot of people can attest to that seeing the movie on Disney Channel that, you know, these relationships are very iconic, very close, you know, branded. Mm-hmm. And they're just really, really cool to see, like every single person, just like their arc, you know, throughout the process of the show and rehearsals, and the characters are really coming to life. You know, not only the four evils, but you know, especially with Chad, Audrey, Jane, Fairy Godmother, just, you know, the plethora of cast that we have. Mm-hmm. Just seeing all the characters build up is just mm-hmm. super, super cool. And like for me, like this is my first Disney show, you know, mm-hmm. so like mm-hmm. it's kind of cool being able to like, you know, finally had the dream of like, oh my gosh, like I get to be in a Disney show and like get to be an iconic character, and like, you know, it's like super fun. And
And the show is very, very well thought out too.
Yes.
Every character has a backstory, so there's been a lot of us to work with and kind mm-hmm. of research with, so it's been really, really cool to kind of, because not many shows are kind of like that,
yeah.
which is what's cool about working with a Disney show, because mm-hmm. there's so much to kind of yeah. work with and mm-hmm. use as inspiration and
yeah, things that have been established.
And yeah, all that you need definitely.
To consider.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. very cool.
Now, it's going to kind of be part of my segue to the other part of the program, but you've been. Kind of. Have you danced before
yes.
and all?
Yeah.
And all. Good, because. sorry about that, Joan. but in A Chorus Line, mm-hmm. They're out. This is what you're doing for love. This is you're pushing yourself. You're taking that risk and mm-hmm. all that. Have you found that your limitations that you thought you had have been broken and you're exceeding what you've been able to do in the past and have grown while working on this?
I think especially for RCT, we do a lot of dancing shows in general, but
right.
I think Descendants is something that's definitely a lot more hard-hitting than we usually do.
Mm-hmm.
It's very cardio-intensive, very hip-hop, very mm-hmm. urban, and so I think it's just really different for us.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really improving everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it's just, you know, just taking just an 8 count to go over reviewing, or even just, you know, doing it over and over and over again, you're always improving mm-hmm. some way at rehearsal, and that's the way I pretty much see it, you know?
Yeah, totally.
Good. Good. Well, that leads me into the Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival, and I think some of you are familiar with it. Hannah, you noticed DeSales University.
Yes, I am familiar with the Shakespeare Festival.
And well, they're doing a wonderful summer lineup. They're getting back in the swing of doing live performances, just like Reading Theater, Reading Civic Theater. Is doing, and last year they were outside. They had some help from the neighboring business to build an outdoor stage. Now everything is, from what I understand, is coming inside again because they have a wide arrangement. And I just want to go through what they'll be doing, and if any of you are familiar with this, that's good. They're opening the season with a show called Every Brilliant Thing. Now, this is not a Shakespearean play, but it is about the family and youth dealing with depression and getting through that, and how we all are dependent upon each other for our get-together. Like you said earlier, it takes a village, and that's part of it. And in that, there's also going to be a wonderful program which talks about what one can do and how one can help things people get through. And if you are one of those people like me who really enjoy that, that is going to be opening up, and I got to get this out here. It usually works in rehearsal, but we have opening up, and I'm going to have to fire that producer I have. He doesn't always keep up the pace. Anyway, doesn't have things marked for me. Oh well. That's me. Anyway, Every Brilliant Thing opens up on June 7th and runs to June 19th. A Chorus Line, which I've been mentioning throughout this, opens on June 22nd and goes to July 10th. Now, Every Brilliant Thing is being done in the Schubert Theater there, and A Chorus Line is their main stage production. So the both theaters are very close to each other, but you know, but that's where you'll find it. And then after that, we come to the Shakespearean play opening July 13th, Much Ado About Nothing. It's a wonderful comedy, and you'll enjoy that. All these seem to have a lot of humor, uplifting, and love involved mm-hmm. with them, different ways. Following Much Ado About Nothing is August Wilson's Fences. And that will be running July 27th to August 7th. So those are essentially their adult type productions. They have a special event where there's going to be a singer in there, and I'll hopefully catch up. Yes, Dan Dominic in concert on June 27th. And it's he's been in a number of the productions there before, so those of you who have been there may remember him. Now we're also doing, they're also doing something for children. There's children's theater production for the year is Little Red. And what it is, it's a little bit about Little Red Riding Hood and all the other, a lot of other fairy tales and characters from there and what goes on with them and all. So if you have young children and you're interested in having them come out to see some good theater, that's wonderful because they do it in their Schubert Theater, and more often than not, they're some of the children are up on the stage surrounding the three-quarter round stage, and it's rather interactive. And speaking of interactive, I'm going to go back to Every Brilliant Thing, because that also will be interactive with the audience and all. One, it's a one-person show, and there'll be... I'm really looking forward to seeing that. My curiosity is piqued. And of course, Shakespeare for Kids. They have a program in which you can go and take the younger folks, kids with you, and they get a chance to learn more about Shakespeare and all, because from what I'm understanding, it's starting to be lost in the school system. So I hope you know this, that you might consider this as a good way to look into that. Because Shakespeare has really written works that have transcended the years mm-hmm. and are very common to our everyday life. It's just because it's a so-called highfalutin language. You know, it's really very, very down to earth. The poetry in there, when done well, and they do that poetry very well at the Shakespeare Festival, and bring it to the point where it seems like normal everyday conversation, yet the Bard's work is in there. And that opens July 28th and runs through August the 6th. And yes, they are doing, again, the Lenny Fowler Willpower Tour, and they go to schools in New Jersey, Delaware, and Pennsylvania, and take a whole day to do a show and do workshops with them so that the older students in high school can get a little better idea about what's what Shakespeare is all about and learn to enjoy it. And they have their gala on June 4th for Luminosity. And all. And if you're interested in finding out more about the Pennsylvania Shakespeare Festival, you can go to their website, pashakespeare.org, and excuse me, and find out about their season, how to get tickets, where it goes, because it's a beautiful, beautiful campus, and you can relax. They have usually have entertainment a little bit before the main stage productions and all. So you can really have a full theater experience. They also have meals and snacks and that sort of thing. And of course, you've probably seen this. This is Shakespeare with a red nose, a clown comedy on that. that they also have souvenirs there and all, and I love getting them because they remind me of the fun and the people I've met. Patrick Mulcahy, Tina Slack, Patrick is the producing artistic director. Tina Slack is director of marketing and promotions. And there's William Casey Gallagher is up there producing that. And they have, and all of those up there, I started learning about them through Lisa Higgins, who was up there. And they have all been such wonderful people to talk to learn things about, and they're very, very helpful, as are all their volunteers there. So I hope you get a chance to get up there and see these shows. It's such an experience. It gets you out of the neighborhood, and you get a chance to see what's going on elsewhere, but also it's a way of bringing back theater to you to appreciate it a little bit more and all. And I'm not ruling out the wonderful theater groups that we have here, such as the Reading Civic Theater and all the other theater groups that have appeared on the program. You folks have really done wonderful jobs in creating an environment in where people want to be in and live. So thank you for all that you've done, and I want to thank each and every one of you for being on the program
tonight. Thank you for having us. Seriously, thank you.
And break a leg with the show, and your gala opening yourself.
Yes, thank you.
That's right.
You're welcome. And I want to just leave you with this thought about it. As you retire for the day and get some rest, think of all the good things that have done, large and small, that have come to you in your daily life, and appreciate them and share them. And then kiss today goodbye and point us to tomorrow.
Heck yeah.
That's where it's all about. And we'll have another tomorrow next month on Backstage. For Backstage, the Reading Civic Theater, and all of you here at BCTV, we'll see you again next month. Backstage, take good care.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.